Many of you here may have heard that when we had the financial crisis of 2008 and 2009, you may have seen that a lot of people were blaming the accountants, that we had this thing called fair value measures, FASB 157, and they were saying it was the accountants that created this financial mess and that it was because of this fair value measure that there was all of these problems. And I imagine that there was tremendous political pressure put on the FASB to make some adjustments to that fair value measure. And was that the most pressure that you saw during the period that you were in charge as chairman of the FASB?
Yeah, that's probably two questions there. One about fair value and the financial crisis and dealing with that. And then, you know, was that the point at which, you know, I at least felt most political pressure? I guess on the first question, you know, as I kind of testified in Congress and other places, there was a lot of misinformation going around, at least in my view, during that point in time. First of all, Statement 157 did not introduce new fair value. What it did was provide a common definition of what we mean by fair value and a framework around calculating fair value in different asset types, liabilities, different market situations, and also provided standardized disclosures for fair value. So what it said was that here's what we mean and here's kind of how to do it wherever another standard says you either have to or can use fair value. That was one point. The second point was that as studies by the SEC and others showed that for the banks, most of their assets are not on fair value. They're not on mark-to-market. Loans are on amortized cost, subject to an impairment. A lot of debt securities were on an amortized cost basis, or if they were on fair value in the balance sheet, they were not mark-to-market through P&L and the like. Third point, I think it was important, is that the need to write down underwater assets when the markets go down and the economy goes down and there's problems is hardly new. Ideas like lower of cost or market have been around for decades, if not centuries. And of course, starting in 2007 and accelerating in 2008 and into 2009, we had very problem markets. I mean, some of the assets were not called toxic assets because they were gems in the rough. And you see the same thing going on a little bit now in Europe, where there's delayed recognition of losses, right, and the like. There was also, you know, some people said, well, having to mark down the financial assets, take write-offs, is causing a pro-cyclical effect. It's exacerbating the meltdown here. And that probably was possible in that, you know, people were in an effort to raise more capital or avoid future losses would go to the market and try and sell what they could, they needed to. But actually, subsequent studies, including one by the Boston Federal Reserve, found that for the most problem assets, that didn't occur, largely because there weren't any markets for them,
right,
and the like. So I tried to make all those points during the crisis. And at the same time, as many people said, Tim, what happened starting largely summer 2008 and going into the early spring of 2009, people used the words unprecedented, and I think it was, and people say we didn't have a playbook for that situation. I think that's true. Clearly, there had been markets for these toxic assets, for good or for bad. There had been trading, and you could do the accounting. But when the problems started to emerge and everybody began to understand what was backing all these asset-backed securities, mortgage-backed securities, CDOs, CDO squared, derivatives written on those structures, The markets began to dry up, and so accounting and valuation become very, very difficult in those circumstances. And so we had to provide several rounds of guidance starting in the fall of 2008 and going into the spring of 2009 to try to help people, you know, best they could, try and do proper accounting. And I actually feel fairly proud about some of those efforts that we, they weren't perfect, but again, it was an unprecedented, difficult situation. I don't feel personally that was, from a political point of view, pressure, the one that was the most challenging, though, when I was at the FASB. I think that was probably the development of Statement 123R, which, among other things, requires the recognition of compensation expense for executive and employee stock options. And the FASB had gone through something of a bitter fight on that back in the 90s, had really no allies, and decided at that point to require footnote disclosure rather than recognizing expense in the income statement. Following the reporting scandals, I think there was a fair amount of sentiment among a lot of parties that, these ought to be recognized as compensation expense, and that not doing so had maybe led to some unfortunate behaviors at some companies and the like. And so we undertook that again, but just like the FASB had in the 1990s, certain segments of the corporate community, in particular the high technology industry, biotechs, venture capitalists, mounted very significant opposition to that, including walking the halls of Congress, getting Congress to introduce all sorts of bills that would have overridden us or required alternative accounting that would not, in my view, have been proper. In that period, I probably, in a period of a little more than a year, must have been summoned to appear at maybe six or seven different congressional hearings to explain what we were doing. But luckily, you know, we had the support of other parties. We were supported by some very recognized parties like Alan Greenspan and Paul Volcker and Warren Buffett. We had support of many, many other parties, investors, that was very important, the accounting profession this time around, which had not really supported the FASB in that fight in the 1990s, and some very important people in Congress. The people on the Committee of Jurisdiction in the Senate, the Banking Committee, being Senator Richard Shelby and Senator Paul Sarbanes were very much, supportive of what we were doing, as were other important people, particularly in the Senate. So eventually, we stuck to it and, kept up our thorough process, and what emerged was 123R.
A tough fight, but it was well worth it, wasn't it?
I think it was an important outcome because it was important to show that we could conduct our independent process. It was important also from a viewpoint of international convergence, which was kind of a fledgling exercise at that time, but the ISB was also working on a similar standard.